What is up, Ecstasy Nation?
Ooh, I love the sound.
Yeah, like that. That's what I've been thinking lately. We're going to call our fan base Ecstasy Nation.
I think we should. I think it's got a great ring to it. I love it.
So today on the show, guys, we're going to be looking back at 2011 in indie music. We are also going to be celebrating the legacy of Sophie, looking back on her career. But first, Dylan, I want to open up with a question. You have been thinking a lot about taste and how taste works specifically with time and how things change over time. As we're going to be looking back at 2011, that kind of stuff's just been in my head. Is there an artist for you, I'm curious, that you either loved at one point in time or hated at one point in time and then went the other way on and then even went the other way again? Like, for instance, I've had that for me with Death Cab for Cutie. I've just gone back and forth over time. And I'm just curious for you, is there an artist who, like, you have been deeply invested in and then also...
The back again is the interesting thing, because I definitely think there are a lot of artists that I've had that kind of a switch for. And I was actually thinking about this as well as far as it pertains to 2011. I know at that time it was about 1 year before I was really starting to actually kind of make the deep dives through music blogs. So the vast majority of the records that I love from that year I was not familiar with. And I think the only artists that have released records that year that I still like that I was listening to at the time are Radiohead and Starfucker, which is hilarious to me but not surprising in the slightest. And
Ref, can we bleep that out after? I really want to keep this a family show.
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely not.
Sorry,
cool for this. I'm sorry about that. For all you listening at home who needed to muffle some ears, all you
the young Ecstasy heads, the young audience
that were stumbling a few moments ago. But the one that I've told you about a lot is Vampire Weekend. I mean, they're the classic example in my head of like really prejudging a band based on just my own sort of perception of them without doing any homework whatsoever and being completely, as far as my own opinion, just like shamefully in the wrong.
So when you weren't a fan of them, you weren't really that familiar with the music?
No, I heard the singles, and in my mind, yeah, it was that idea of like the most generic bad take imaginable of just, you know, the insufferable preppy kind of just super upbeat and optimistic without really sort of acknowledging their privilege or anything, just whatever, any kind of thing you could put into them without actually understanding anything about where they're coming from. So that to me sticks out pretty notably. But I don't know if I've had any that I've really kind of flip-flopped back and forth
like
on.
Have you ever had like a favorite artist or favorite band that you eventually like hated?
No, I definitely don't think hate. I do think like there are a lot of bands, and the gold standard in my head for this sort of thing are Silverstone Pickups, where they're a band that I love because of the fact that they are so derivative of a band that I love, in this case, the Smashing Pumpkins. And now, you know, there are a lot of bands that, you know, in the past where I was just like, oh, yeah, they remind me of this other band that I love. That's great. And now I'm at a point where I just don't want to listen to anything that feels too overly derivative of something. If it's just they're not bringing anything of their own to the table. And I definitely feel that way about Silverstone Pickups, even as much as I still will go to bat for a handful of those early songs. And I think some of it holds up pretty well. It's incredibly derivative and it just doesn't do a whole lot for me. But I don't know if I have any relationships with art. Like, I think one band that I might feel this way about is like Chiodos, that post-hardcore band. Like, that's sort of a band that I don't listen to at all, and I totally thought that I, you know, was completely sort of over, but I would not be surprised if I still fell hard for the music again listening to it at this point in time. But part of me feels like I had moved past that, and I'm like, no, if I would take a certain song and I'd just be like sucked right back into it, even if I hadn't heard it in like 5 years. But it just depends on the artist. I mean, I think what's part of that too is that I'm listening to genres that I just didn't really listen to a whole lot, you know? So like, I wasn't really listening to, you know, soul or ambient or noise music, you know, 10 years ago. So a lot of the stuff that I really am super immersed in now, it wasn't even on my radar necessarily. But yeah, I feel like that changes all the time, but that's a really interesting. So are you like not into Death Cab at all anymore? Are you like at a point now where like the old stuff, it's hard for you to hear the old stuff because of how bland his voice has become?
They were,
not
I was
literal voice, but you know what I'm saying?
I think I was so invested in them, and there's something about the way like your favorite band becomes a vessel for yourself. Like you just like, you project all of your own identity onto them and you sort of build your identity in conjunction with them, especially when you're at a young age.
Yeah, and you're so reading too much into things. And
and so then as you kind of grow out of your former self into like a more mature self or something, at least for me, on my end, as someone who is pretty like obsessive about taste or whatever, I would like grow to like be like, oh, I in my head was like, oh, that's like indicative of like a dumber Danny at like 16 who didn't have as good a taste as like 18-year-old Danny. And then like 20-year-old Danny looks back at 18-year-old Danny and goes like, what the fuck were you thinking, man? Like you, ref, once again, I bleep that. I apologize to the children out there, part of Ecstasy Nation. But anyways,
we've just lost like a third of our listenership. That's it. I know.
We have a very, according to Spotify, we get the breakdown on Spotify for artists, Abdul, and I'll show you that after. But most of our listeners are 10 and younger. It's a weird, I would not have thought for like what our subject matter is, but yeah. Anyways,
I am so impressed with Zoomers, man.
With just those kids, they're into music, man. But
into criticism, and that's what I'm proud about. But yeah, what you were saying though,
But the thing specifically with time and where we're getting into this 2011 stuff in terms of like how trends work and things being in style and out of style
and our own relationship and identity to ourselves and the
culture
around us.
And I've been thinking a lot about like the idea of timelessness. Like, is there such a thing as like a timeless classic album? Because I feel like, I personally don't think there is. I think like the album.
It seems like a paradox. I'm sorry to keep interrupting you, but the idea of that seems like it really couldn't exist. And I romanticize that, of course, with anything. But yeah, like the older that I get, the more it. I don't know. Like it just, if it's not like a classical composition, it's like on some level, it's just whatever. I don't know how that would really materialize any classic idea of just the way that culture works. Everything is just folding on itself. So continuously. But what were you going to say?
I'm curious too about like, I've been thinking lately, like about what stuff could come back next. And I think maybe at a point in time, I've heard like, I always reference them, but Haydn and Cohen on their podcast, IndieCast, big shout out. They've been talking about how like nowadays, at least in music criticism, if anything, publications are looking to hire people who don't want to talk about what's like cool and popular, who have like a unique take on like a specific genre of music that's always been like disregarded. So like if you have like a new hot take on Nickelback, like there's more interest in hearing that these days, or why new metal, we should look back at it positively. Like that kind of cultural relativist attitude of like everything is worth examining if you're from the community that it's addressing or something like that.
Which brings up larger conversations about who has the credentials to be reviewing what and everything. But I mean, it's an important thing to think about and a really interesting conversation. And
I guess what I'm curious about is, do you think we're going to ever get to a point in time where Nirvana is considered less cool than Nickelback? Could there ever be a swap down the road? Because I'm personally, I will say it on air, like I'm a Nirvana fan, but like I that stuff doesn't hit for me the way I think it does for other generations. Because his voice has been changed for me by growing up hearing the post-grunge bands. Like I grew up hearing Nickelback and Creed. So when I hear Kurt do that same vocal style that inspired them, I still like project onto it like, oh, this is fucking Nickelback. But now I've come around to like, I put on Nickelback and... Dude, Someday and How You Remind Me, those are some well-written songs.
Well, I was going to say, first of all, that I do think Dave Grohl himself might, like, pretty much destroy any kind of, like, cool legacy that Nirvana has for anybody himself.
Foo Fighters got the nom today. First and foremost,
I think he will single-handedly destroy any, like, cachet that they ever have before he passes away, in all seriousness. And Dave Grohl's a great guy, but, like, man, what a fucking corny rock uncle. Jesus.
Rock uncle, did you listen to the last episode of IndieCast?
Oh, yeah.
Did you hear Cohen call him Uncle Rock?
I was going to say, I think that I probably had that, like, just subconsciously embedded in my head after hearing that. Because, like, oh, that's exactly what
it is. I loved that definition, too. I've been thinking about that since he called Dave Grohl, or he called the Foo Fighters Uncle Rock, the type of rock where it's, like, your uncle who will give you a beer, but he still, like, cares about you.
Like he's gonna do shit that your parents like might not let you, but he still ultimately cares about your well-being. And he's not really gonna lead you astray, ultimately. That is fucking Grohl to a T. But I definitely think that could happen. And there was another point that I just wanted to bring up as far as just the whole idea of culturalism and it obviously, being a part of, the larger realm of optimism where just everything's on the table, like nothing is just inherently awful. You could make a case for everything.
But there are definitely still taste hierarchies, right? Like I feel like at this point in time, there's still easy targets. Like I feel like Imagine Dragons right now would be like an easy target for people. But I could see a point in time down the road where they're considered.
Well, that's just the thing. I think that's where we're ultimately heading, where like no matter what, I think it seems hard to imagine that there would ever be a point where there isn't like some low hanging fruit of some kind, but it's the idea being that like today's low hanging fruit is going to be tomorrow's like think piece that like really, you know what I mean? Like nobody's like, we're just at a point where you could really, there are people like, the conversation has just become so far ranging that people can make a case for anything. And
so much of that is just like music criticism for the music critic's sake of just like, look, yeah. I'm the person who can make you like,
right. Maybe, I'm the definitive author. Like I am the authority on this very niche band that yeah. you've heard one song from, and didn't do anything for. And now I'm going to prove to you why they're awesome.
And it's just like a headline too of like, look, I'm going to show you why Nickelback is tasteful or something. Right. Like, yeah.
And this I will. Yeah, no, it's exhausting. But, it honestly, to bring that into what we were talking about today, it like review or listening back on a handful of 2011 records, there are definitely a few where it's like, oh yeah, this would always be considered cool. I can see why it was, you know, reviewed well at the time. I mean, I'm thinking of like that first Ice Age record, like the eternal cool New York ideal, like whatever. Like there are some things that are just always going to be critic catnip. And I say that also as somebody that fucking loves Ice Age and love everything they've done. And I'm so excited for their new record. But like, most of the records that I love from that year are records that, like, again, if they had really released a handful of years prior, would not have been received nearly as well.
Yeah.
And it's like that year when I think about a lot of, like, the last handful of years, that was, like, a major turning point. We talk a lot about, like, oh, yeah, 2012, 2013, but, like, 2011, where, like, the writing was inescapably on the wall.
Yeah. I mean, 2011 is a huge year for me personally. And I wanted to.
Oh, like, yeah. Well, as far as like a lot of your like taste defining kind of acts.
Yeah. That was my year I graduated from high school and my freshman year of college as well, the fall of. And so, like, mm-hmm. just like a like classic like turning point in your life or whatever. And there was also specifically musically the first year I remember like keeping up with music publications. Like in high school, I definitely had like contemporary bands that I was into and I would know when their albums were coming out and I would get into them. But 2011 was the first year I remember like checking Pitchfork and Stereogum every day. And like Fantano also kind of popped up that year.
Yeah. We literally had a very similar just music critical trajectory. You were in music much longer, but in terms of like that happening, like there were a handful of contemporary groups, and then like late in high school is when like everything changed and I was scouring.
I wanted to ask you, so what 2011 for you, that's your senior year of high school.
2012. It was 2011, 2012. So it was like 2012 was when I graduated. That was the year that I was really starting to make the rounds. It was like 2011 was like the last year that I was like not looking at blogs.
So setting the stage in your life, 2011, were you're keeping up with what bands at that point?
Well, that's
what
I was saying. It was like the Smashing Pumpkins and Silver Sun Pickups and Radiohead and Starfire. Like it was still a pretty
King of Limbs was big for you that year.
Well, no, see, it wasn't. And that was the thing is that like I like King of Limbs, but like I was still just like, oh yeah, no, it's all about like the older Radiohead. The new stuff is not good. And like now, you know, obviously I enjoy King of Limbs. It's not one of my favorites of theirs, but like I was not listening to very much electronic music and like the electronic music again, like Starfuck or whatever else that, you know, whatever I liked at the time. It's just like everything aside from like the alt rock and some of the like 90s indie is just very, very different. Outside of like the Pumpkins and like Radiohead and like Flaming Lips and Dinosaur Jr., I don't listen to really any of those bands that I listened to in high school at all.
So when I look at this 2011 list of albums I have in front of me here, for the most part, these are albums that you would have gotten into post that year.
Yeah, literally all of them.
Okay.
Like I don't even know if I outside of like Fleet Foxes, I'm not even sure if I was aware of like any. Yeah, Bon Iver and Fleet Foxes I was aware of, but like really probably none of the other ones.
So I'm going
to
read
back. Oh, no, M83 just because of Midnight City. But like it's such a so weird to think about. I want you to read back, but like think about my relationship to music and how different that was. It's like, oh, I was aware of some song on the radio, so I knew this act, but I didn't know anything about them at all. And it's just like night and day now. Just yeah. Thinking about like how I really haven't heard that specific song outside of just listening to the, you know, within the context of the record as a whole, but
I think some of that also is the way media has, the way we take in information has changed. Like just the smartphone now with the app, it's like, obviously Facebook was around in 2011 and stuff and smartphones were around, but there's something now, maybe that's just my personal experience where I feel like now I'm just every single day I have music news at the tip of my finger. I mean, it was there 2011. What am I talking about? That was the year I got into it heavy. It was still readily available, but.
Mm-hmm. What were you going to say with this list though?
So I'm going to list off of the albums from that year that really struck me as being standouts in India. You added a few here too, and I wanted to.
Oh yeah, I was gonna say my number one actually is probably gonna be surprising to you because it's not a band that we talk about very much, but yeah,
that's like, where I was going with it. I was kind of curious. So we've got Bon Iver self-titled album, Destroyers Kaput, M83 Hurry Up We're Dreaming, James Blake self-titled debut album, Eye Contact by Gang Gang Dance,
yes,
Panda Bear's Tomboy, Fleet Fox Helplessness Blues, Kurt Vile Smoke Ring for My Halo, War on Drugs Slave Ambient, Atlas Sound with Parallax, Real Estate's Days, St. Vincent's Strange Mercy, Tune Yards with Who Kill, Ice Age New Brigade, and Girls with Father, Son, Holy Ghost. What are those? What stand out to you right off the get as big, big albums for Dylan Hughes?
Well, yeah, I was going to say, this is, you mentioned that, yeah, 2011, obviously, just where you were in your life, there was no way it wasn't going to be like an enormous year for you. It obviously, like, musically was really not aside at the time, aside from just like my taste continuing to actually, you know, congeal into something that felt like my own. But looking back on it though, 2011 really was like one of the last like enormous years for the kind of shit that I'm into. I mean, like Eye Contact, Tomboy, Parallax, like those are all enormous records for me. I've fallen very hard for Gang Gang Dance over the last handful of years. And like that, they're a band that speaks to like what I was, or one of many bands that I was talking about when I mentioned how like the Brooklyn early aughts noise scene is just completely take, like a lot of those groups, Black Dice, Anko, I mean, those are like, that's like the bulk of the stuff that I have like gravitated towards the hardest over the last couple of years. And so like, yeah, Gang Gang Dance, I mean, I am obsessed with them. Eye Contact is basically their Mary Rather Post-Billion, sort of a, you know, smorgasbord of everything they've sort of attempted throughout their last several records, just kind of brought to the fore, really maximal, bright melodies.
I love when a band does their smorgasbord record.
Yeah, their smorgasbord record brings it all kind of to the fore in a way that just feels like it's more eclectic, more experimental, but also in more immediate sort of structures. I just, oh, dude. Yeah, I love Gang Gang Dance. They're an incredible group. I mean,
never listened to them.
Again, it's like the kind of thing where I do think it's something that like just gives you a good idea of kind of keying into what really, again, it's, I don't know how to frame this, because again, you were listening to it, you are familiar with a lot. That's probably the only one of these records that you really are not familiar with, isn't it?
No, there's actually, there's a couple on here. The Ice Age record I never really listened to. That, those might be the only two, which are both kind of the post-punky, or is Gang Gang Dance?
No, Gang Dance is basically, they're like psych pop world beat dance music. I mean, they actually started out as like kind of a world beat like noise band, and like they've gradually grown a lot more dancey and poppy as they've progressed, but like they're definitely,
I don't want to tell them what to do, but if you're going to name your band Gang Gang Dance, I feel like you should be doing post-punk, so
yeah,
I'm going to knock them down.
Sure.
One bag of popcorn.
One bag of popcorn for that. Yeah. I'd love to hear they're taking a straight up post-punk record. But yeah, like, Gang of Dance really are just one of those bands that kind of are doing, they exemplify really everything that I want from music, which is just incredible melodies, improvisation, an element of surprise, which again, like, speaks to what I like about Anko and how they've kind of ruined a lot of music for me. But I think their best record and the last really great thing they've done, but Eye Contact or Gang Gang Dance's discog up to that point, I think, is really, really worth listening to. And that record in particular, I think you would really enjoy. But yeah, Parallax by Atlas Sound, Tomboy by Panda Bear. I mean, those are enormous records for me. I mean, like that Atlas, the greater Deer Hunter, Animal Collective Universe, like all that stuff is just like exactly
again, that's what your, I want to,
that's my wheelhouse. We haven't been getting a lot of really great stuff from any of these artists in the years since. So, I mean, yeah, it was a kind of a, it felt in some ways like, you know, the real last cap off to the aughts before, you know, things really started to change, you know, quite a bit in terms of just, well, obviously critical favor, but also just the kinds of things that like, you know, but just happening music. There aren't necessarily a lot of groups doing the kinds of things that these artists were doing specifically, like trends, and I mean, there's a lot that it speaks to, but like, yeah, I mean, we had a Gang Gang Dance record a couple years ago, but it's been like, it was 7 years or so since the last one, so yeah, some of these artists just receded. We still haven't gotten the Sound follow up to that record, so some part of it's just like, you know, they don't release a ton of music, part of it's just, you know, people have moved on, but it's, yeah, that was a pretty enormous year for me.
Yeah, Atlas Sound, I kind of get the impression that was just put to bed at this point.
It feels that way, yeah. I mean, he hasn't said anything. He actually has played solo shows in the last handful of years, but, I mean, there's been no new music, so yeah. We'd assume so.
Looking back at this list, though, man, it's just been like, it reminds me, too, of last year putting together, like, the best of the previous decade stuff, because this is obviously the sort of first year of that decade. And it's just like, it's, man, like, that was the decade of our youth and stuff. Like, these are just, like, the classic albums from, like, our pinnacle years. And so they just, like, have such, like, an emotional resonance with me, too, as I look back at some of these. Like, when I put on that, like, I put on that Kurt Vile record for the first time in ages, and it brought me right back to, like, my dorm room.
This is probably my favorite Kurt Vile record, too. Yeah. I think I discovered, what was it, the 2013 record, Walking on Pretty Days or whatever, first, yeah, just because it came out that year. But, you know, Smoking for My Halo is the one.
That's my
one too. Fucking love this record. Yeah, it is like, so good.
That's like, he sounds like Neil on that album.
Oh, yeah.
Like, in the best way
I
possible.
I mean, just, and like, I think all of his records are pretty good, but this was just like the perfect balance of just imagery and arrangement. Like, a lot of the, like, his latter work kind of meanders. It feels just a little underworked in some ways. Like, this was just like lightning in a bottle. I mean, Smoke Ring was just, just a great, fantastic folk record.
But now, so where you got guys like him and War on Drugs who are sort of doing...
Oh, and that was an interesting thing too, 2011, just their break. Like, that was like the point where they really kind
both
of...
Both kind of made names.
Well, yeah, really started to come into their... Like, develop their own specific individual artistic identities, mm-hmm, is really what it was.
Mm-hmm. But those two guys who are kind of backwards looking, take them, but then if you want to start talking about 2011 trends and sort of what kind of started then.
Well, you know, it's interesting too. Real quick, I was like,
yeah,
you're right, that War on Drugs definitely started out the decade as a backwards looking group, and even though they haven't fundamentally changed their sound that much, just by virtue of the sheer ingenuity and craftsmanship, in some weird ways they've kind of come full circle as one of the bands that are kind of pushing things forward right now, and not in terms of, again, stylistically, but in terms of just sheer like production and arrangement.
I mean, I think they get into, it's that interesting thing about how time works with taste, where the forward, mm-hmm, they're forward looking because they're bringing back, and we're gonna have a bunch of this conversation.
I know, they're just bringing, a very specifically interesting group in this.
They're bringing back trends that weren't cool for a long time, so
recontextualizing them with new
interesting
elements.
Ways, yep. Exactly. So like, yep. if you ever listened to Dire Straits,
I'm not familiar, but yeah.
I feel like War on Drugs sounds a lot like Dire Straits. I mean, they obviously get the 80s Henley comparisons and like the 80s Heartland kind of just overall vibe, which is super on point. And they bring that back with just like post-rock kind of approaches too, to like song structure and stuff. It's very interesting how they recontextualize it.
I don't know if you're familiar with Pitchfork's critic Stuart Berman, who wrote the famous Centipede Hurts review. He actually wrote the Slave Ambient review, and at one point he mentions how a lot of the records sounds like the Springsteen and Spiritualized records in your record collection just melted into each other on a hot summer day.
Beautiful.
And it's exactly what,
yes,
yeah, like 100%.
I love that. Yeah.
I thought you'd appreciate that. It's very apt for what they're, yes, doing.
That's all right. So, but if you take those records and then you compare it to an album that I would argue is forward thinking with, there's probably records we could talk about that it's drawing from, but it just to me feels so fresh and out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. That James Blake self-titled album.
Oh, yeah.
And it's one that I also feel like really shaped the tone from an underground perspective at that time, shaped pop throughout the next decade. Like, well, as we get into Down the Road, we're going to do an episode on 2011 and hip hop specifically. Take Care, Drake. I mean, this is going to be part of my character now. I'm just the guy who brings up Drake every fucking episode. But they had him and 40 had the James Blake album like in the studio. Like, so even at that point in time when James Blake's still sort of a slightly underground record, like his stuff is making waves at a higher level too. And like he completely shaped, like, as much as I'm not a fan of it currently, this type of stuff, like Halsey, I feel like, and like all of that production just like seems rooted in James Blake to me.
The, like, real somber, melancholic, like minor key,
super minimal,
like minimal.
Oh, ton of reverb.
1,000%.
Like, yeah, like
he honestly, that self-titled James Blake record is arguably the most. I mean, it's one of, but arguably the most influential record of the decade.
I mean,
we're talking top like five.
And
probably.
When I see it, man, with 2011, like that first year of the decade, it's like that's the one where it's like, whoa, that really set a tone for like the next 10 years, like that on both like an underground level and like a pop level. Like, that was a tastemaking. Like,
that's the thing. The point that you brought up was that it doesn't really matter now. You know, we look at music being made in 21, where they're coming from, genre wise, like who they're working with, or whatever. That style of production is taken for granted so much. But he, you know, that is like James Blake put that together. I mean, like that fusion, it's like the post dubstep gospel, like what was it? It was like core sound before even the first like record came out. It was like, because he brought in some of the R&B and gospel stuff just with the self-titled and some of the subsequent stuff, but like the early like post dubstep juke garage kind of two-step thing, but with some subtle kind of like bluesy undercurrents to
also
it.
Also, like I feel like that was a prime example of what at the time they were calling alternative R&B.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
That was like,
it was alternative R&B before the PBR&B thing really started.
PBR&B. Yeah. That was the
another Pitchfork critic coined
that.
That
was a classic, the PBR&B.
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir.
Yeah, because I mean, like, too, you look at who he worked with over the years. Like, he works with Frank down the road for the rest of the decade down the line. Then he works with Kendrick, right? Mm-hmm. Haven't they done stuff together?
Yep.
He's worked with
Future, worked
with Drake. They had 0 to 100. The first version had it.
Yeah, he's worked with them all. I mean,
Beyonce.
Yeah.
Lemonade. Like, I mean, he shaped that decade entirely. And just, and it's so interesting too. I always thought the way, like, the year prior he had put out those EPs, that string of EPs.
Yeah, that's what I was speaking to. The first three EPs that really kind of developed it. And then
he doesn't even sing.
Well, that's what I was about to say, is that he developed a really interesting core sound that built on it sounded like nobody else, that continued to build on itself with each subsequent EP, but he wasn't singing any of them. And then when the LP came out, it just blew everything out.
It was like a magic trick. It was like he set it up. He was like, I'm going to show you guys that I'm like a cool DJ. And then like, you guys are like biting, waiting for the album. And then when it comes out, it's like, oh, I'm
not
also
only can
a songwriter.
He sing, but he's an incredible singer. He's a great songwriter.
Yeah. Like borderline one of the best voices of the decade too.
Oh, I mean, he's not somebody that I think about as much as like one of the definitive voices, because so much of my head is just always on production. But like, no, of course, he's definitely got one of the best voices of the decade for sure.
Incredible.
Him and Sumney and Justin, and I'm always throwing my hand up there. But I mean, like, yeah, he's definitely got one of the, for sure. But it is weird to think about, how much his music has developed and how different that sort of landscape is. And like, he feels like a go-to producer for pretty much anybody. But like, it was such an anonymous, it was like earlier on, but like, it's so crazy how different that landscape was. And like Adele's, rolling, was that her self-titled?
21 came out that year.
I don't know when that was.
That was the
popular. I mean,
that was the biggest album of that year, in terms of sales. And then she also had the biggest song of that year, Rolling in the Deep. But I did want to credit that the number two song, Party Rock Anthem.
Yes, you did. You mentioned that to me. Yeah,
baby. Saw him live too.
That's sick.
It was sick. They opened for Girl Talk and they sprayed the crowd.
When was this?
They opened for 2011. 2011 was such an awesome year. I saw them with Lewis Walters. We brought a half gallon of my dad and my mom's J&B Scotch whiskey that we stole from the cabinet. We drank it in the car at Meadowbrook. Then we saw them, and then is it LMFAO or LMA?
LMFAO. Yeah.
They sprayed the crowd with like tequila, like a tequila hose. They had a guy on stage who was like a dancer, and
Dude, where's the live stream? Why don't they fucking get some, like,
one of those, like, Russian nesting dolls of t-shirts. So like, he had a t-shirt on for each song, and he would take it off for the next song. It would have, like, a new title on it, and then he would take that shirt off, and he had a new title. So it was, like, shots, 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 shots. Yeah. Incredible show. One of the best shows I've ever seen in my life. Yeah.
I want to know where the fucking live streams are. Why aren't they fucking live streaming this?
They should have been like the Grateful Dead. There should have been tapers there.
Honestly.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, one of the most incredible live acts of all time. What were the set lists? What were they doing?
No way. You've got a bootleg at LMFAO 11?
They did a 12-minute party rock anthem.
With strings?
But like, okay, that's also another group where like Taste, I feel like they were like taken as like I'm going to sound like an idiot here. I think they sound great now. I feel like you put on Party Rock Anthem. Yeah. I think
we know where that's where you're coming from. Yeah, no, it bangs. It's I don't think so, but like we're talking about like objectively, like, oh, is this like a hit? Like it's no surprise this
it's
hit.
It's a Party Rock Anthem. Yeah, and they're related to Motown. They're dude, come on. That's such a great look. So you guys can't see it right now because this is an audio format show that we're doing, but our producer, Bref, is currently holding up a picture of the two dudes from LMFAO.
And we should crop our faces into that image and use that.
That could be for the cover? Yeah,
I think so.
Yeah, actually, that's a great pick. I think that should be you can work on that for the rest of the episode. Thanks, man.
Sure, no problem.
What a team sport. God. Love Bref.
Yeah, but looking back on that year, man, I mean, like, apart from that, too, boom, you got the fucking Real Estate record. That was a huge one for me. I don't know about you. Did you ever
It was a little bit later. I mean, I actually remember asking you about Real Estate shortly before we lived together, and Atlas wasn't out yet. But, yeah, I mean, I still love those three records. I think they're great. And, like,
that was, like, a real, I feel like, a defining album for a very specific trend in indie rock at that time. Like, I feel like the reverb heavy, jangly, beachy, every band had like beach in their name kind of sound.
Yeah. All the bands signed to Captured Tracks, I'm sure, have been like kicking themselves for that, not like, writing easy, like for the rest of their lives.
Polaroid photo guitar sound, like just like the hazy. Yeah. But that record is
hazy,
beautiful.
Lazy, crazy. Look, I love Best Coast. She's great.
Dive came out that year too, right?
Yeah.
Yep. I mean, that's a little different, but...
Well, I mean, it still speaks to a similar ethos, I think. I mean, the styles are a little bit different. Dive is definitely drawing more from a post-punk tradition, but it's still a jangle guitar sound. I mean, like, the influences are a little bit different, but they're coming at it coming to a similar kind of place, I think. But, yeah, I think, again, like, a lot of these records, the only ones that really, like, Days, not hard to see why it, you know, took off. I feel like Helpless Blues and Strange Mercy are very, like, obvious indie taste-making, right? Like, no surprise that they did as well as they did. But a lot of these, I'm kind of surprised, were as well-received. Like, we're at a point now where, you know, like, whatever, a lot of the more... I guess we're going to do a part two of this, so we'll get into some more of these other records that we'll going to be talking about.
Because we're specifically not touching on the saxophone records today,
the soft
guys,
pop,
the 80s.
Adult contemporary, yeah. Smooth jazz, inclination, stylings, or whatever.
Part two, we're getting into that.
But yeah, there are a lot of these records that definitely feel like they were at sort of a cross with like what was happening in the larger indie music. And I think, you know, we're obviously better for it. And it just went to show how much things were shifting. And another one is Thundercat's Golden Age of Apocalypse, and like, obviously, you know, that's a record that probably would have been pretty well received at any point in time, but like, yeah, we're at a point now where we're seeing this a bass player link up with it's just somebody that like was playing in a lot of bands that now is like, you know, fronting his own career, and like, it's got an incredible voice. It seemingly came out of nowhere and is like backed by this incredible production. I mean, that is just something where it's, you know, I don't know, like, it just like, he's kind of came out of my radar out of nowhere, and I don't know if, you know, it really would have taken, like, his music necessarily would have taken off without there being the kind of established, you know, brain feeder, low-end theory kind of sound that, like, Fly Low and all his contemporaries had kind of been hyping up the last handful of years. And that's no shade to Thundercat, but, like, again, some of the stuff is just culture being ready for, you know, certain things when they happen. You know, like, I love that, you know, Thundercat's incredible, but, like, would his music have been as popular if it got released a handful of years prior? I don't know if it would have. I don't know if it would have taken him, if it would have taken him a lot longer to really break out. And it just, yeah, like, I think the landscape really went down. Like, the overarching kind of landscape of music, there was just a lot. I mean, this 2009 and 2010, this was a big thing, too. But 2011, was like, there was no real, the definitive kind of taste-making hierarchy was really kind of blurring. And, like, I don't think there was really an established sound for that year, aside from like the saxophone. To me, is like the biggest, like, not development, so to speak, but like, that's just where things were going. Like, everything was becoming like off the table again.
Yeah. So to contextualize that too, for if there's listeners who don't know,
what there was a lot of us. I'm sorry.
The saxophone sound. The best way I can put it is I was rereading the review for the M83 album, and Ian Cohen has, I love in Pitchfork when they would do the hyperlinks, he has a sentence where every single word is hyperlinked because he's got a different reference for the saxophone records. The sentence says, at this point in the year, I shouldn't be surprised by a saxophone solo, and every single word is hyperlinked. And you click like, and it's the Bon Iver record, and you click this, and it's there. So looking at the records we've got, Bon Iver album brings back the saxophone. The Destroyer album brings back the saxophone. M83 brings back the saxophone. And like you've been saying, it's all these like 80s adult contemporary.
80s schmaltz being recontextualized into cool indie guys groups.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
But I, just for the record, I want to say Deer Hunter recontextualized the saxophone a year prior on the Halcyon Digest, for the record. They it made is, this cool before any of these guys did. So
I mean, like,
just want to throw that out there. And if you have an earlier reference, please give it to me. But Deer Hunter did it first.
When you think of that, like, that 80s sound, that schmaltzy sound, like, what, like, what do you think? I always just think of, like,
Lionel Richie. I'm joking. No, it's just, it's a really, like, overproduced, buttery kind of keyboard. I don't have a specific artist in mind aside from, like, I think Bruce Hornsby is definitely, like,
that was
one of the go-tos.
Bring back.
I don't know. I don't necessarily, like, have any real priests, because again, it's like there were a handful of stuff obviously on the radio.
I was thinking that, like, you belong to the city.
You Built the City in the 80s? Was that
by Jefferson Starship? Yeah. You're goddamn right, it was.
Yeah, that okay. That's probably what I would think of as like 80s schmaltz. Like, that's like a platonic ideal.
Yeah, that's ugh.
That description be used for that.
Starship is trouble.
Yeah, and so I'm obviously curious about like what, you know, anything like that this year might look like, aside from like, because the obvious thing like moving forward is just like anything like a Foo Fighters record that's just like unabashedly, you know, sort of flying the flag for nothing but classic rock without doing anything interesting with it. Like, that stuff is going to be relentlessly shit on. But like, I don't know what like taboo sound, like, you know what I mean? Like what is really going to get kind of like overtly maligned for the next couple of years.
Well, when you mention Foo Fighters, it makes me think Foo Fighters are like the last gasp of rock and roll, right? Like when everyone talks about rock being dead, like Foo Fighters are like the ambassadors to rock.
They're, I think, still like well, flag. Foo Fighters and like Pearl Jam, I think, are like the other one.
So looking back at 2011, do you feel like rock was still alive at that point in time? I mean, the Black Keys were huge at that point in time. Like they,
well, yeah,
they
were. That's an interesting thing is I think that
they had like hit singles. Oh, that yeah. Were like no, the top.
They had like hit songs that were like overall radio, not just like rock radio, but like overall were pretty yeah. big. Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So rock was.
Well, I think it's an interesting thing because like, and I don't want to like necessarily timestamp one specific year, but like the rock is dead thing has been set for decades. I mean, like literal decades. I've been growing up. Literal yeah. decades. Since at least some point in the 70s, yeah. rock is dead. So, like, I...
But
you know,
really, I think it does feel, at this point in time, like, it's just, like... Well, like, I've been asking every person who I meet who's under the age of 20, I always ask them, like, did kids in your grade, was there always still, like, a kid who would, like, start a band? And they're like, no, that's not, like, a thing. And they're like, I think kids now, like, if you want to get into music, if you're like, well, that's, like, your thing, like, you DJ, or not necessarily DJ, but, like, you get, like... Fruit Loops or fucking yeah. Logic. Oh, yeah.
And that's been the case for the production. Last several years, for yeah. sure.
Yeah, and that's yeah. cool. Like, no hate towards that. I'm right. just like...
I would say since at least, like, 2013, 14. That's probably
because it's just,
case.
Like, I don't think that's, like, an icon anymore of coolness to be like, oh, I'm the, like, the... I play guitar and I have a band.
Right.
Like,
well, and this is what I was going to say to you is that I think that's absolutely, like, a good place to start is just as a barometer. Like, are people younger than 20 getting into bands? Do they like bands? Are they starting bands? Whatever. My only, like... argument that I would just make for like, well, of course rock isn't dead is just because in my mind there are always exciting, like, every year there are at least rock bands emerging that are exciting. And so like if I even look at this year, it's like, oh, like, oh yeah, like I know for me that like new records from Ice Age and like the Spirit of the Beehive, which are a band that we haven't really talked about but I am very excited about, like they're going to interest me more than pretty much anything else will. I know, or I mean, that's whatever. I just like it totally depends on the group. And I think that like, you know, if people are still making groups and are still curious about like trying to do anything with the well-worn forms of rock music, then it won't actually be dead. But yeah, it's all just predicated on, you know, just the interest still being there. I mean, the media coverage has been lackluster for, again, like decades, whatever. It's just like, that's just what that is. But yeah, it's definitely the receded dramatically from that culture. And like, there's no question, you know, the vast majority of interesting music being made every year is not necessarily proper rock music. But, yeah, I don't know. I wouldn't say that it's dead, but, like, yeah, is it on life support? Yeah, probably. I mean, there's just so much to me, in my mind, interesting, like, happening on Bandcamp and, like, in specific music scenes. And, like, so it just it depends on how you frame it. But it's, as far as, like, overall, like, you know, interest within the form, I think, yeah, it's, of course, diminished.
Dead is definitely, like, a heavy word. Like, that's definitely, like, a classic, like, rock critic trying to get a headline type thing.
Exactly. Because I was just, like, if you were to say it's dead, it's like, oh, yeah, there's, like, literally no rock bands at all making anything interesting. Like, it's just...
Right. It's not dead, like, but it's just, like, it's no longer a... I'm not even going to say the dominant trend because it hasn't been the dominant trend for a while. It's no longer even like a, it's like now like kind of a niche thing. It's like,
yes, you're like, I think that's definitely fair to say. Like it's rock music overall, like, has become a niche concern.
Like it's almost like switched with comic books from 20 years ago. Like we're like,
yeah. Oh, like, for sure. Or yeah. comedy.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just like, it's
or cooking.
Or yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
Chefs, have no, rock, chefs have been the new rock stars chefs for 5 years now, at least 5 years. Yeah.
Or
I
like
mean,
Twitter, like, Twitter, Twitter stars for brand reps. Like if you're like an Arby's Twitter guy,
oh yeah,
you're the new rock star.
Yeah, no, all of the above, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. But yeah, I like honestly, that's again still like the lowest hanging fruit. Like that's like classic rock, like. Nothing's going to get more maligned than a new Greta Van Fleet record this year. Like, even, like, if the Chainsmokers release a fucking triple LP, it's not going to get more maligned than, like, a Greta Van Fleet record will. And that's just, like, me trying to be objective. Like, that's just what I think is going to happen. But...
Well, when you met... I mean,
I'm just curious about... Again, it's just, like, what else... Like, obviously, you know, for certain people, like, a lot of, like, trap music is still kind of maligned or whatever. But, like, again, there's... At the same time, it's still really
but like
pushing
beats,
the culture forward.
Trap beats
forward,
are like
using
Target commercials now too. You'll hear
yeah.
like the.
That's true.
I mean, I'm making that up, but it wouldn't surprise me if it is true. I'm gonna place my bet right now on the show.
It's a safe bet.
I think another interesting way to measure the index of like rock, if it's played out or dead or whatever, is you mentioned classic rock, like what position classic rock holds? Because I do feel like for us in middle school, there was still like, if you started a band, there was like a great American songbook of like classic rock songs that you just expected every other kid to know. It was just like, if you showed up and you had a bass, guitar, or drums, like I knew we could play.
It's not Smoke on the Water now. It's Friday by Rebecca Black. And there's nothing wrong with that. But that's just where we are.
But there was like a
book. I'd be happy to show you those chords, my guy.
But it was like everyone, like you knew like you had to, like you knew they were going to know a couple Zeppelin songs. You knew they would know some Red Hot Chili Peppers or like Weezer. Like, does that ring true for you, Bref? Do you remember? Like,
well, that's also like an interesting thing too, thinking about how, because I agree that like that's just kind of how it was for us growing up, but like also just specifically timestamping us, it was like a bunch of Zeppelin, maybe a Weezer or Green Day song. It was just like, yeah, testament to the fact that like there were still contemporary acts that people paid attention to that were actually omnipresent in the culture, that like there was an established songbook that they were adding to, that just because they weren't your parents' music didn't make them any less relevant.
Right.
And you cannot really say that about rock music anymore.
Well, that's what, yeah, like Haydn in that book, Twilight of the Gods, that he wrote about classic rock, like he, that's one of his key themes, is like, why is it that this music that is at this point in time like decades old, why is it that people still know it so well? Like, it's still such like when you're in your teen years, you just like get into that, like why, how is it held such a ominous, not ominous, but like such a omnipresent looming presence over American and or maybe British culture as well, but American culture for certain. And like, I just don't know if that holds up anymore. I think at that point in time that might have passed. Like, I think kids in high school now and maybe middle school aren't putting on Dark Side of the Moon as often as like kids during our time.
There are most kids in middle school, I would wager, have no idea what Dark Side of the Moon is. No idea. The vast majority have no idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's fine. But you know, and that's actually, that's healthy. That's how it should be. But man, it's so disappointing to think that like, Yeah, it's just, it like, oh yeah, just like rock music, just it gets phased out and it's just like, oh, well, we just don't have the receipt. But that's how culture moves forward though.
But maybe it comes back. Maybe just like the saxophone in the 80s stuff, maybe monster fucking riffs.
Oh, I think they will.
And white dudes singing about mama, mama is going to come back down the road and we're going to have a cool new version of it.
I think so. Well, I think Greta Van Fleet are trying to do that. And I at some point, you know, they might actually hit their, they might, the culture might actually come to meet them halfway. I don't know.
That's like another, like going back to the Nickelback thing of like, they're another easy target. Like,
they are.
You know, like you can just make,
that's why I keep bringing them up, because again, they're the example of like, if there is any maligned sound or genre this year, you would think it would be like, my obvious take is the Chainsmokers, but no, it's fucking Greta Van Fleet. It's anybody that's flying the flag for rock music in its purest form. Like, they are going to get the most.
There's a couple of good Chainsmokers songs.
Which ones?
All right, so I came around to, like I said, I'm not a huge.
I want to hear what your idea of like the, like your, like, all right, most,
I love
maligned
act. I love the one with Chris Martin. I love.
I know you do.
We, I want something just like this, because he sings about like, right, like, I've been reading books of old ancients and the messages, like sick lyrics, and it's Chris the boy, and
man, he is falling down a dark hole since those Eno days.
Dude, he's, you know, he's,
well, doing, I mean, things aren't doing well with him. I mean, obviously, I'm sure he's still like recovering from the whole Paltrow.
He's on,
but
his
like,
hero's
as
journey.
As far as like our artistic advancements, I mean, man, he was working with Hopkins and Eno in 08, and now he's with the Chainsmokers.
That's
poor guy.
Hey, he's bouncing around.
My heart's going out to Martin.
He's on the tip of the tongue of culture, and you're fucking on the back of the palate. All right, so
I'm not that far up.
All right, but yeah, guys, look out for our second episode down the road that we're going to be doing on 2011, looking back at those specific saxophone 80s influence records that we were talking about.
Oh, also real quick though, would you say that James Blake, it's got to be James Blake or Bon Iver, which of those would you say is your favorite record of 2011? It's got to be, or Take Care, maybe, right?
If, man, it's a three. Those three records are so defining to me.
Right, and you don't have to pick one. Those would be the three, though.
If I had to pick one, probably Take Care.
Because my only question was, of the, like, the 2011 records, how, like, do they sound better to you today? Like, I don't know if you've heard Take Care recently, because we know what we're going to talk about it today. But like,
Take Care for sure.
The last time that you heard these, do you feel like they sound? Yeah.
Yeah, they all hold up for me really well. Yeah, 100%. And that's, it's. They're beautiful to listen to like 10 years later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think all of them are. I actually listened to that Girls record today for the first time in probably 3 years. pretty fucking solid.
Yeah.
Like, obviously, like, that was another one of those things where it was just, it's so easy to dismiss because of how, like, middle of the road it seems and how it's just, a lot of these are just, like, rips of older rock songs or whatever, but, like, really tight craftsmanship. I really do enjoy that record quite a bit.
Yeah.
Like, they're not, like, again, a band that I ever think about that much, but, like, both those records are fucking great. Sorry, again.
Beautiful. No, no, beautiful.
No, with the curses, you know, with everything.
Oh,
that's all. I just keep bringing that up. But yeah, no, those are both those records and that AP, Rest in Peace, JR. I mean,
yeah,
just fucking tragic. I would have really loved to have gotten another girl's record somewhere, because it's the kind of thing where it's just like, oh yeah, one and done. It was perfect. They didn't make it anymore. But just to come back at some point down the road and record another one, you know, and just like kind of an MBV sort of thing almost would have been nice.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just a shame. But yeah, no, I think all these records for the most, but the ones that I listen to all honestly sound just as good to me, if not better. I don't know if any of them in my mind have really aged all that poorly. I'd have to really look down. I think, you know, some of the Chill Wave records don't sound as great as, like, you know, they probably did in the moment, but like, I still ride for the Toro.
Yeah, and those little records. Trends, like, that happen at that moment.
The thing is, I think with most microtrends is, like, the principal artists are generally still pretty good. It's, like, the wave that, you know, leaves a lot to be desired. And you can say that about, you know, any of the James Blake, Drake, whatever. It's, like, with any kind of trailblazing micro-movement, whether or not it grows into something larger, it's the stuff that... Or even with, like, you know, fucking Nirvana and all the post-grungers we were talking about. It's, like, yeah, there's, like, the couple of handful that started off might be pretty decent, but, like, there's so much more that follows that kind of ruins it for everybody else. And, like... I was actually going to bring this up as a larger point in this conversation. It's something that I think we should maybe get into a little bit more next time. But part of me feels like Chill Wave was honestly, like, partially responsible for the death of indie music overall. I think, like, the dismissal of Chill, like, the how much Chill Wave was dismissed.
We don't have the bomb drop.
No, we don't have the bomb drop
yet, but we need.
I'm working on. Yeah, we're gonna transition to the Soviet dog in just a moment. But I do think that, like, you know, that is something where. Like, you look at, like, the overall evolution of, like, indie rock, indie pop, electronic music, a lot of the stuff that was kind of drawing on itself and, like, the backlash against that and how immediately there was a shift after Chill Wave's, like, wave had crested, so to speak. Like, I think there's something to that.
I feel like maybe it's because I'm not keeping up as much, but I feel like the micro trend thing has passed away, too, because I feel like for such a short time you had, like...
Because everything's a micro trend.
Is that what it is?
I want to hear what you were going to say.
Because it was like Chill Wave, and then it was like Vapor Wave, and then it was like mm-hmm. Witch House.
Yeah,
and then
those are all, like, well,
Alternative R&B or PBR.
Yeah, no, like, those are all, I was going to say there was, along with the Witch House thing, there's also the, like, Cloud Rap as well, with A$AP Rocky, Clams Casino, yep. Lil B. Like, literally 2011 was like the definitive year for cloud rap, and, like, nobody thinks about necessarily that much anymore. They're just other hip hop artists, but, like, that was definitely a major shift in what was happening in hip hop.
So you, as the guy that I go to who is on the actual tip of the tongue of culture, while I'm on the back of the palate, to once again use that horrible analogy, am I wrong about that, or is micro trends, has that kind of passed away as a trend in and of itself of music criticism, or am I just out of the loop? Are there still micro?
No, I definitely think there are still microtrends. I don't know if there have been any that have really I've seen that have really kind of taken off. Because, I mean, again, with, like, Chill Wave or a lot of this other stuff, I mean, they were, like, dominating, you know, the music cultural discourse for a while. There hasn't been anything that I'm aware of last handful of years that has really. I mean, I guess it would be the closest thing that I can think of is, like, hyperpop, which was a great segue into Sophie. I mean, that's, like, one of, like, at least one of the more popular ones.
You know, actually,
yeah.
That makes me, now that I think about it, Matt Ward is showing me a different little internet music trend every week. What am I talking about? I'm just getting old. Old, guys.
It's all right.
Across the span of the show, you guys are just going to hear me get older and older.
Yeah, that's just what it is. But, yeah, hyperpop is tight. Definitely something that, it's not surprising that Ward's into it, given how much he likes electronic music. I don't necessarily, I think it might be, you might enjoy some of it just because of how much you appreciate just melody in general. A lot of the, like, arrangement might be a little, you know, much for you, whether or not it feels forced or whatever. But, like, I do think, like, at its core, some of the stuff you might really enjoy. And I was going to ask you, too, I want to hear what you're going to say, first of all.
Well, to transition to the Sophie stuff, I was going
to
say.
Yeah, have you listened to Sophie?
I listened to the album.
Okay,
and
cool.
To connect to the internet trend stuff, another thing that I find so interesting about it, apart from the melodic aspect that you brought up, is, like, the voice processing and that mm-hmm. ability to be able to,
oh,
like,
of course, the vocal processing you would appreciate.
Yeah, and to just be able to, like, create, like, a
you can be the performativity of it. Like you can be whoever you want to be through new technologies and stuff musically, like yes. more than you could ever want to be before. It's a beautiful thing. I think
And that I think was a huge appeal of Sophie's artistry. I mean, beyond actually how much she pushed music forward and beyond the fact that obviously she was really a trans icon for all intents and purposes. Mm-hmm. And one of the few the icon word is where I'm kind of, I don't want to put too much, I can't really speak to, as much as obviously what people meant for other people. I know that she was somebody that seemed to really mean a lot more to the trans community than a lot of other trans experimental artists that that I listen to and enjoy. And what you were speaking to too, though, as far as being any version of yourself that you want through the process of the internet. I mean, I think that's something that she really kind of exuded throughout everything that she did and showed a lot of people that was the case. And
I thought it was so interesting how she uses artistry specifically and uses the pop format as a way of pointing out that that we're all just performing ourselves at every moment.
Being human is a performative,
itself. And hearing what she does, like I said, with the vocal processing, that album on just first listen alone was incredible.
I'm really glad that you enjoyed that. Yeah. Yeah. And it's got a lot of range to it as well. I think I told you she put out that product compilation a few years prior, which when she really started to take off in 2013, it was through some single collaborations with the PC Music Collective, AG Cook, Hannah Diamond, Girlfriend of the Year, a bunch of producers that started to cultivate the sound known now as hyperpop, which I think, I don't know, with any other genre, it's some of these acts, there's a lot more going on than just whatever this might entail, but just to kind of simplify this for the sake of the, easy conversation, hyperpop was pretty much, established through the sounds of PC Music and Sophie and what they were doing. It's a really sort of hyper-maximal take on electronic music that fuses, sort of kitschy bubblegum pop aesthetics with harsh industrial noises and a really abrasive maximal kind of production values.
Glitchy kind of.
Yeah. Glitch industrial. That's pretty much what we're speaking to with it's bubblegum pop at its core.
It
is interesting. It's the kind of thing that could only exist post internet. And there aren't a ton of artists that I'm super compelled by within this realm. I mean, like I said, I enjoy a lot of the PC Music Collective's work. There are a handful of other acts that kind of skirt along. I think Let's Eat Grandma are kind of within that realm. Not really. I mean, Arco's dabbled with some hyperpop. It's not really Sophie's really the definitive artist for what this sound kind of is and thematically, sonically, whatever. And, I don't know who's going to take up that mantle now, but she really, we think about the sort of evolution of Avant Pop. I mean, this whole decade, the second half of the decade really belongs to a lot of her and PC Music's advancements. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. along with the James Blake, Drake, or 40 minimal style production. Yeah. I think a lot of what we've seen, production value wise, and tripping over myself here, but I do think a lot of what sort of she kind of brought to the fore is now kind of taken for granted within pop production, and it was just not the case before she started making music. And I mean, it's just one of those things where it's gonna, that style is kind of woven into the fabric and will be now kind of taken as a norm for a lot of people. But I think a lot of artists are really gonna ride her. Black Dresses are another one that I like. I don't know. I'm sorry, this is kind of convoluted, but yeah, she was not an artist that I listened to a whole lot, but I was so impressed with what she did, and she had so much potential, and I am still really in shock about everything. I mean, she had just dropped a new single a day before that, and yeah, it's insane. I still just can't believe that it happened, but I,
made such waves too. It seemed like, I mean, I feel like everyone who I saw that day on Instagram or Twitter was posting. I mean, such connections throughout the music community. And another artist who I feel from the underground was coming up through pop and making waves, you were saying, influence with sound.
Yeah, she actually is another. It's interesting that we had this specific, exact conversation about James Blake earlier, because I do think there was a very similar sort of thing happening here, beyond her work with a lot of other people. I mean, really just through the Charlie XCX connection, she had completely broached the mainstream, and I'm sure she would have been collaborating with a lot of other like enormous names moving forward just by virtue of like their specific relationship. But yeah, I mean, Evan, yeah, anything that's for the next, I mean, I'm sure the next like at least several years of like avant-garde electronic pop music are going to sound very much like exactly what she was doing. Yeah. So, you know, I hope that we get some artists that are really kind of pushing her sound forward. And, you know, I wanted just to see more of, and I think that we're going to see this moving forward, but just artists with that kind of unabashed sense of self and, you know, just what she sort of exuded was what I just hope that we see more from with people in the culture in general, is that just unabashed, like, authenticity and integrity to who you are. And, you know,
an incredible artist.
What she stood for. Just, yeah, rest in peace, Sophie. Rest in peace, Sophie. So, you got a pick for us, Danny Man?
Yeah. So, guys, this is it. Here we go. The first of many to come of Dr. Rock. That's me. Doc Rock's Rock Doc of the Month.
Oh, shit. Is Doc Rock in the house?
That's right, guys. So, from now on, Audio Ecstasy, as you all know, Ecstasy Nation, is a bi-weekly show. Every 2 weeks, we give you an episode. So, the first of those episodes is going to be Dylan giving you those top five albums of the month. He's going to be on trend. He's going to be letting you know what's going on in the contemporary world of music. But that second week, you're going to be getting Dr. Rock's Rock Doc of the Month. So my Rock Doc for this month, Dylan, is the new documentary about Cream, the music magazine. Mm. It's on Amazon Prime. I watched it a few nights ago. Very interesting. Very interesting from music nerd and music critic perspective, but also very interesting from a Detroit perspective because Cream Magazine was based here in Detroit. Mm-hmm. It was located on Wayne State's campus.
Was it formed in the 60s? When was it?
Yeah, 60s, 60s, 70s. Maybe it was the early 70s.
I couldn't remember if it was the early 70s, late 60s.
They started the year after Rolling Stone, and I never realized that their name even was like a parody of Rolling Stone. Like it was like the Rolling Stones magazine whose name is based on a band. And so Cream was like, all right, fuck it, we're Cream now. Like, and so many legendary writers and just like rock minds and critics there. You've got Dave Marsh, who was the editor. You've got Lester Bangs there, who eventually moved to Detroit, which is incredible. Although I will get into down the road here how I'm not a huge fan of him personally.
Yeah, no, I would love to unpack that.
Just, you know, let's just do it now. I mean, the guy was just like a misogynist, and like so much of his criticism was like
pretentious, insufferable asshole, smug,
they're like the patron saint of edgelords. Like he would write about like this guy's wife should have, like his mom should have had an abortion, just dumb stuff. And like in the doc, I will give them credit that they have a woman list some of the horrible things he says, and she says like, oh, let's put it this way, I was not a huge fan of the guy, and I appreciate that they like gave a counter narrative to like.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my God, he's Lester Bangs, such an amazing critic. Like,
it's a shame that such a great critical mind, you know, was put, or like, you know, such a, I mean, he could have, whatever. Like, it was so much just fucking like trite, hacky shit that like could have, that he spewed that could have just been much more interesting. Like, he's a brilliant dude, but like, man.
He had good taste. Like, I'll give him that, but like, and they also get into like how, I mean, Cream was like straight up misogynistic. Like, whoever the author was, or the critic who wrote about the Runaways' first album, like he called them a bunch of bitch. Like it was just called them that, and just was like, it was just just stupid stuff. But the doc is completely worthwhile. You get some crazy fun stories. You get like from a Michigan perspective, Chad Smith grew up in Bloomfield Hills. So in the 70s, Cream moves to Birmingham.
I was gonna say, actually, you know what? There was a Cream magazine, Cream magazine, like a museum actually in Birmingham that I went to.
Oh, really?
I literally, yeah, it was a part like you can actually just tour this building, see all this memorabilia and shit. Yeah, I went there like a few years ago because I, you know, worked at Birmingham for years, and yeah, we should actually check it out one of these days. I totally forgot about that. Yeah,
yeah.
Chad Smith. Ahead. So they moved to Birmingham and when?
They moved to Birmingham in the '70s, and Chad Smith jokes about it. He's like, I was a kid, you know, and I was reading this magazine. This was like my like. You know, pre-internet, this is my, like, way into the world of culture that I'm interested into.
Oh, no, Mr. Smith. Sorry. Okay, continue. Just want to make sure I'm on the same page.
Yeah. And he mentions, he's like, one day on the back, I see that it says, like, Birmingham, Michigan. And I was like, that can't be right. He's like, so here I am, 12-year-old Chad Smith. I get on my bike, and I ride the 5 miles down Woodward. And I get there, and it's this nondescript building, and I'm looking at it, and I'm like, no, this isn't it. This is, I don't know what's going on. Sure enough, the door opens, and Alice Cooper comes out. And I'm like, holy shit, this is it. Cream Magazine, it's right here, man. This is real. And just, like, watching it, I'm like, that's, like, right up the road from where we are right now. Like, it's just like those little moments of when like national history really does connect to your local history are like exciting.
No, I mean, I've definitely thought about that. Like, if we were, you know, like 20 years younger to think about, or 20 years older to think about, like, you know, at just like being somewhere downtown and then just like seeing Dilla just like perform somewhere, or just like, you know what I mean? Like, just something like that where just like you can't, I wouldn't be able to believe this is happening just right in front of
you've
me.
You've seen B-Rabbit, Eminem.
Took me a second.
Dude caught B-Rabbit in one of those legendary underground battles.
Caught him at National Coney. He was enjoying it a little bit too much.
Caught him and him just downing Coney dogs. For the non-Detroit-based Ecstasy Nation out there, Coney dogs are something that we eat in Detroit.
And Lafayette's the spot. I mean, if you eat at National, it's hard to take you seriously.
Yeah, but, fuck you to all of you.
But no, that duck sounds sick, though. I definitely want to check that out. I mean, I've learned a lot about Cream just through that rock criticism book that I told you about and, like, going through and checking that space out. But I'm sure, like, the behind-the-scenes stories are just ridiculous.
It's, I mean, like, it's incredible, too, to see, like, some of the people they talk about coming through Detroit and, like, just to visit the Cream office. Like,
oh, yeah, right.
Springsteen. Mm-hmm. That was really the name, the only name I remember. But they got Springsteen to Detroit.
I mean, you mentioned Alice Cooper walking out of there. That's pretty tight.
Yeah, that's cool.
That's tight. Yep. I'm into that.
You gotta love it, but...
But so, yeah, is that that's all we got for...
That's all we got for you guys today.
Cool.
Ecstasy Nation, we're going to see you guys again in 2 more weeks. We appreciate all you've done for us, audio heads.
Stay safe out there.
Yep, Ecstasy stay out. Safe. And to the children out there, we're going to work on our swearing next time. I apologize. Ecstasy out.